think I want to make this film only because I was invited to by Adnan, you know, by a voicemail asking me to come. I realized for some years that we sort of let the Palestinians down, you know, me and my generation of journalists, filmmakers, who have visited the occupied territories, we realized that we had a responsibility of telling the truth of this story to our audiences. The truth being that this is an occupation which has no basis in human rights, in any legal system. This is something that we were supposed to have stopped after the Second World War. And once you realize that, you also realize that the way it is portrayed in the West, in our countries, the way it's, I was told about it when I was young, was a totally different story. I mean, a lot of people in the West are actually just structurally being lied to about this part of the story. And I felt basically that I had let the people down in a way, because of all those years. I mean, I've remained being a committed filmmaker. And when there was an opportunity such as 9/11 or the first and second Intifada, the Gaza wars, you know, I played my part in news gathering and things like that and making films about it. But never have I noticed any change in public opinion after portraying the truth about the Palestinians and their plight, you know. That's why I really felt bad about. It was a couple of years ago that the producer of my first film, Joost Verheij, who's a producer of Dokkai films, said to me, you know, you should go back. You should go back to that family that you visited in 1987. And I didn't want to do it because I felt I had let them down. I felt I hadn't taken my responsibility well enough in portraying their problems. So actually, I thought at that moment that it, why do that again? You know, I realized that the people must have lost all their land. I knew from Hisham that his life was also very difficult because I got into contact with him. And I thought, yeah, why go there again? You know, why go there again, film them again, and again leaving them with all false expectations, false hope, and then going back to the Netherlands, make a film, celebrate it at movies that matter, you know, have wine with everybody, you know. And I didn't want to do that, basically. It's only when Adnan sent me this voicemail, Kees, when are you coming back, that I thought, well, okay, now I have to do it. And I thought also, okay, when I have to do it, I do it with my son. No budget. We do it with our own money, with our own cameras. When the reunion is a disappointment, you know, when the film fails, I had the feeling when I come back there, I should be honest and pure, not with any second agenda about filmmaking and things like that. So I told my son, you better film me because I really want to be open and honest with the people that I meet again. And at the point that we were filming, we were not sure that we had enough material to make a film. And when we hadn't succeeded in that, that wouldn't have been a problem also for us. Because for me, it was important to see them again, you know, after all these years. Yes, well, there is no other party that could, you know. Our politicians have different agendas, and I think only when there's a public outrage, a public outcry, will our politicians put this on the agenda. When will it become a public outrage or outcry? If we as journalists and filmmakers tell the story. I know, I've been there, I've worked at these editorial rooms, and there is, well, every chief editor knows that you get some problems when you portray the Palestinians truthfully. You know, in the Netherlands, it's even difficult to use the word occupation. You get into trouble with a lot of pro-Israeli pressure groups. You know, so it's very difficult for journalists to tell that story. And some of them, and me included, sort of, we got demotivated. the impact that we had was so little. That doesn't mean that we shouldn't continue. I hope there will also be a next generation that see the injustice in this story and that pick it up. But I actually do believe that we as journalists have failed in that respect. These changes are immense. You know, when I was there the first time, it was 87. It was just a few months before the first Intifada. It was, I mean, people had so much hope. I mean, the family had hope that my film would help them. But after that, everybody had hope that the Intifada would help them. That resulted in the Oslo Accords. In those years, there was really hope that the Palestinian state would be achievable in their lifetime, you know. Yeah, if you look at it now, I mean, I don't know if you've ever been to the West Bank, but there is almost no free land anymore. There's only settlements. It has totally changed. The landscape has changed. The confiscations have become so immense. But also in Hebron, the daily struggle to drive Palestinians out of their houses, that has become immense. And what also is different is that there's no basis for hope anymore. So, there's no viable political chance that the West Bank will ever be returned to the Palestinians. And everybody knows that also. I mean, that doesn't mean that a lot of people are willing to give it a fight, and maybe a final fight even, but there's no reason for any hope. That has changed. I think we should realize that especially when there is so little hope, people become very special. They become also heroes in their own lives, and it's very difficult to live your life when there's so little hope. My message would be: let's never stop uncovering injustice. Let's never stop believing in people, in their power to be heroes in their own life.